Joining us this morning. Hi, Tama. Good morning.
Hi, thanks for having me again.
All right. So do we know how much market share from traditional banks have digital banks eaten up over the last 2 years?
Yeah, so right now, if you're take a look at some of the data as of June, you know, we're looking at an aggregate market share of around 0.4%. So that is very minuscule in the greater scheme of things, but that also reflects relatively quite nascent profile of these digital banks. You know, a lot of them have actually only started operations within 1 year. So I think it is quite likely that we are going to see this market shares continuing to grow upwards, you know, as given their high growth aspirations. But in the overall scheme of things, you know, we don't expect their growing presence to have a significant impact on the competitive landscapes. You know, one is because I think even with kind of like 20-30% growth rate, you know, their market share will remain relatively small. And secondly, I guess if you take a look at some of the strategy that they, some of the banks are employing, i.e. those that are relying so much on the pricing to get customers, we don't think that is going to be sustainable in the long run. So there will be some sort of moderation going forward, and also a moderation in growth rate as well.
Mm-hmm. And would this assessment, you think, be significantly different if you count GCash, for example, into the mix? It's not considered a digital bank technically, but it does enjoy first mover advantage, still enjoying the most number of subscribers using the e-wallet.
Yeah, I mean, e-wallet is another thing. You know, I would say that, I mean, GCash has got quite a bit of an entrenched position in the Philippine fintech space, you know. But as far as the digital banking is concerned, you know, we're talking about deposit gathering, we're talking about, you know, growing the loan book. I would say that, you know, relatively speaking, it's still a quite nascent market in the Philippines.
Is this trend, moderating growth, is this trend particular to the Philippine market, or are you seeing this across the region, even in the very high-tech economies?
No, I mean, I think as far as growth is concerned, even when I say moderation, you know, we're still looking at 30-40%, you know, and that's relative to like 100% probably last year, right? You know, So it's quite typical for an early digital startups within, you know, 1 or 2 or even 3 years of their operations to grow at this kind of rate, you know. But what we're seeing in other parts of the region is that I think there will be some sort of continued moderation, and that's just a natural way of business, you know. In other parts of the market, like I say, China or Indonesia, some of the digital banks here who have been there for more than 4 or 5 years, no, they are still growing at around 20-30%, you know. So given Philippines relatively large and underserved and unbanked market, you know, it's probably going to be quite some time for them to go into this trade. So we will still see a very high growth rates, you know.
But the limited impact. Is it across the board or just for the Philippine landscape?
I think what in terms of, we were talking about the APAC market, I think it will be across the board. You know, if you take a look at China, who has had digital banks for more than 10 years, you know, in a greater scheme of things, you know, their market shares is less than, you know, 1 or 2%. And we have banks in Korea who have made quite a bit of inroads, you know, into the personal unsecured space. But in the greater scheme of things as well, you know, they're not the top five players, right? You know, in the case of Philippines, I think it will be similar. You know, I think the in the case of Philippines, it will be even more so in terms of because the way that the kind of customers that they're targeting, it's relatively different than what the incumbents are going after. You know, so we will see quite a bit of a limited overlap in terms of competitions, in terms of the on the loan side, at least, going forward.
When do you see digital banks hitting an inflection point? I mean, is there a special number, a line in the sand, when you say, all right, the impact is significant enough, it's making a dent?
I don't think there's probably an inflection point in that sense. You know, at the end of the day, it all boils down to the business strategy of all these digital banks. You know, it is quite clear that, you know, a lot of them really wanted to grow into the underserved segment and unbanked sector. So that basically tells us that, you know, as far as competition on the loan side is concerned, I don't think that it will be as material. No, I think it will take a while for them to go into the larger ticket size kind of loans in the corporate sectors because of the higher funding costs that they have, right? You know, even in some of the markets that are more mature, you know, it's their presence in this corporate sector is very limited.
Mm-hmm. All right. If you look at the net profit, I think we have a graphics of this, the P&L walk of digital banks. When you look at the net profit of digital banks as percentage of assets, in general, they're still a negative. When do you see this turning mm-hmm. a corner? You did say, you know, it's relatively new, nascent stage, 1, 2, 3 years. But when do you expect these digital banks, six of them, in fact, just six in the Philippines, to finally turn profitable?
Yeah, so it all boils down at the end of the day on their strategy and how good they are in executing them. You know, but if we take a look at the average time to break even for all the digital banks in the APAC region, we're looking at around 4 to 5 years. You know, but you know, we have seen in some of the markets, in particular the emerging market side, China, in Indonesia, where digital banks can actually reach that level of viability much sooner, you know, 2 years in China. And in Indonesia, we have Bank Jago that actually become profitable within 1.5 years. And that speaks to a certain extent, the kind of ecosystems that they can leverage on from their parents. You know, some of the leading digital banks in China are actually owned by the tech giants there. Same, likewise, in Indonesia. You know, at the end of the day, it all depends on their strategy. It all depends on their franchises and also their parents' franchises and how exactly can they leverage on that. You know, so in the case of Philippine digital banks, I think as far as the operating environment is concerned, we did talk about the underserved segment that is huge. But at the end of the day, you know, going after the segment comes with risks, right? And I think that's one of the few things that I think will be a key challenge for them. It is at higher risk, and it's going to be quite difficult for them to assess the credit risk of these borrowers that have a lack of credit history.
And another factor, of course, which affects their profitability would be the environment we're in. We know digital banks tend to be asset light, which makes them more insulated from economic slowdowns, perhaps, or volatile and uncertainty over rates. What are your thoughts? I mean, we're still in a higher for longer rate environment, but the bets are on the table that starting next year, at least by the second half, we're going to start to see cuts in the rates.
Yeah, so I think because of their limited presence right now, they are actually going to be a little bit more vulnerable to rate movements. You know, if you're looking at rates that are, you know, a higher for a longer kind of interest rate environments, that basically means that digital banks need to compete based on pricing, right? And right now we are already seeing that some of them offering quite an exorbitant amount and up to in a double digit kind of interest rates, right? So in this kind of environment, you know, in order for them to be profitable, they need to lend to the segments that earn even much higher, you know, than these kind of rates, right? You know, but as policy rates kind of normalize going forward, 12, 13 months, I think they will also benefit as far as their funding cost is concerned, but not as much as the incumbents, because they still need to grow. They want to grow, right? So if they want to grow, then they need to basically compete on pricing. Yeah.
Very challenging for them, I imagine, because right now, you know, investors who are putting in money into a lot of these digital banks, you know, they say that the era for growth at all costs is done. Investors are demanding that you show profit earlier and much, much sooner. We did talk about rates earlier, so maybe I can ask you, Tama, basically a general overview. It's a central bank super week this week. You've got the Fed, the ECB, the BOE, the BSP meeting this Thursday for the last time this year. What's your expectation from the Philippine Central Bank? Are they done with hikes and maybe start talking about cuts, or what are you plotting in?
Yeah, So right now, we're definitely seeing that they're at the very tail end of their monetary tightening, initiatives. Our projection right now is that I think BSP will start cutting interest rates in 2024 in a gradual pace. It will be quite backloaded in the second half of the year, because I think at the end of the day, there's still, inflation is still a key consideration, and also the Fed, the movements, right? Right now, a lot of people are still kind of expecting that the Fed will not move also up until the second quarter of next year. So I think there will be some sort of movements that are happening in tandem in the case of the Philippines as well.
All right, happening in tandem. That's the key word. In general, Tama, central banks essentially turned to the same playbook. Over the last 2 years, they hiked rates to tame inflation with a hope and the perception that once you cut rates, this will give economies that much-needed shot in the arm next year, second half, as we're all expecting. But are low or maybe even negative interest rates truly helpful in empowering economies to outperform in terms of per capita GDP, for example, or in terms of expanding their production structure? How effective are low rates in that sense?
Yeah, I mean, I guess if you take a look at the interest rate before the pandemic, before the rate tightening in 2018, right? We've seen rates at a record low across the world, and even in the Philippines. And during these times, we are seeing a boom in economic growth, and also in the case of Philippines, 6 to 7% growth. So I think there will be definitely an impact on the economic growth. It's just economic sense. Things it will be much cheaper for businesses to borrow, and also for household lending. But as far as whether or not this will, how much of an impact will this be, next year, that all boils down to how much of a rate cut we'll have, and also how, in terms of the geopolitical issues, and as well as the general global economic environment, right? Because notwithstanding Philippines' relatively quite domestic, locally domestic consumption-driven kind of economy, at the end of the day, it's still vulnerable to movements in the global environment.
All right. On that note, Tama, always a pleasure to speak with you. Thank you so much for breaking down the report on digital banks and for giving us your thoughts about expectations from the central banks this week and next year. See you soon. Have a happy holiday.
Yeah, you too. Thanks a lot.
All right.